My name is Adam, and I was raised in Minnesota, right in the Twin Cities. I was born in St. Paul and grew up in a suburb called Woodbury, and both sides of my family lived there growing up. And so I was there growing up and ended up moving to Tennessee for college for 5 years down there. Came back to Minnesota, and that's where my wife and I currently live. Her name is Hannah, and we have a four-month-old baby girl named Ingrid right now. So we're back in the Twin Cities. So, yeah. So we've been living in the Twin Cities for the past about 3 years since I finished college back in the summer of 2013, and then we moved back. Growing up, I grew up Lutheran in the ELCA denomination. Growing up, and so I was very faithful. We would go a lot of Sundays, and then my grandparents went to a non-denominational church, which we go to now, and so I actually went to Sunday school there. But then as I was growing up, I went to the Lutheran church and went to the youth group. My favorite part of it was getting to hang out with all the other youth, and it was a lot of fun. And so I went through the confirmation process, which I didn't fully understand at the time, but it's a point where, you know, you have your confirmation of faith, and that was after I experienced everything I did with the LDS Church. You know, I found a relationship with Christ, but I grew up knowing about Jesus, you know, and I was taught about Jesus in Sunday school, and I remember we had a Bible verse memory that we had to learn, and mine was John 15:5. You know, I am the vine, and you are the branches, and whoever remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. You know, apart from me, I can do nothing, you know. So that was the verse for me that really stuck with me growing up, and so that I knew the whole time I couldn't do anything without Christ, you know. And something growing up that I really enjoyed was going to the youth camps that they had, you know, Bible camps. There was one called Camp Wapagasset in Wisconsin that we went to and heard about Jesus and got to worship and everything. So it was really impactful for me. Yeah, I believed in Christ. I didn't have the, you know, the experiences and the relationship, you know, for a long time, but I believed in Jesus. I believe that he died on the cross for me, for my, you know, to pay for my sins. So I fully believe that. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, take me into your first encounters with Mormonism and
Yeah, so it was the summer of 2002, so I was 14 years old, and my family took a trip out here to Utah, and we actually did a circle tour around the West. So we drove through South Dakota, Wyoming, Idaho, and one of our stops was in Salt Lake City just for one night. But it was a Sunday afternoon, and we got a tour of Temple Square by two of the sister missionaries. And after we got a tour of it, you know, we came back home, and I met a Mormon girl my ninth grade year of junior high school, and got a copy of the Book of Mormon from her and read it, and that's where it all started. But on the way to Utah, actually, something that I had found was a travel book in our van, because we had a Utah, one of those travel books, you know, and I started wanting to know more about Utah. So I was reading this chapter about the Mormon pioneers, and, you know, I've had heard of Catholics and Baptists, Presbyterians, but I had no idea who the Mormons were. It was completely foreign to me. You know, so I was reading a little bit about it, and there was a picture in there of the Salt Lake Temple, and there's also a picture of Joseph Smith, you know, next to his brother and everything. And so I started learning a little bit about, you know, the beginnings of Mormonism, the early Mormon church history. So that was the first experience that I had had.
Did you have any experience in Utah itself that increased your interest in Mormonism?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, right when we got a tour of Temple Square, I mean, it was just so attractive. You know, I mean, obviously I had gotten a tour by two of the sister missionaries, and, they have female missionaries there for a purpose to really bring them in. And it, you know, I got really caught in that, you know, and my dad had said ahead of time, you know, look out, you know, they put really pretty girls at Temple Square, you know, because it draws them in. You know, and it's something that I didn't really realize at the time, but, you know, you go on the grounds of Temple Square and it's like, wow, it just looks so beautiful, you know, like the flowers, the cut grass, you know, they build everything with excellence, you know, and that's what I really caught my attention, you know, is that so many Christian churches, you know, weren't really doing things with that kind of excellence, you know, and I really wanted, it seemed like they had abundant life because of the outward appearance of it, you know, and so it was very, very attractive to me. And then we went into the North Visitor Center, went up that that circular path up into the room where you see, have the Christus statue, you know, and the heavens behind it, you know, and you sit and listen to the recording, a recording of Jesus, you know, and you know, seeing that, it made me think that, you know, Jesus Christ is the center of this church. They've put their focus, you know, put the focus on him. So that really started my interest in that. So, because I had known Jesus, like I had believed in Jesus growing up, you know, and the thing was, is that all I wanted to do was be a part of the true church. You know, I didn't want to be, it wasn't like I was wanting to be a part of something completely foreign, or I was wanting to rebel and find a church like that. But I was just wanting to find the true church. So.
And even when you were younger, did you have that sense of wanting to know which church was true? Did you even have a concept that there was such a thing as a true church, as opposed to a false church?
Right. Not before that time. All I knew was I was going to church, you know, and that I was learning about Jesus, you know, and so all I knew about Jesus was just, it was simple. You know, he created us, and we're fallen human beings, we're sinful, and that we needed him to die on the cross for our sins. Yeah. And so that was all I knew, you know, but it was starting to go to different churches that it started becoming an interest to me. Which of the churches are true? It was a legitimate, you know, interest from going from church to church and then back to the Lutheran church, experiencing the different denominations. So.
Into the years that followed this trip to Utah and this, and you met this Mormon girl, you said?
Yeah, I met this Mormon girl, and she was in my first class of the day, my English class. She sat right behind me. So I immediately wrote a letter to her and said I had went to Salt Lake City, you know, and I had gotten a tour of Temple Square, and I wanted a copy of the Book of Mormon to read it. So the next day she got me a copy of the Book of Mormon, a soft cover blue copy of the Book of Mormon with a folded up letter in it. That it was really short, just a paragraph. It wasn't anything, I didn't feel any pressure. That's the thing, is that for me, there wasn't any pressure for it. She just wrote a letter saying that, you know, I bear you my testimony that, of course, underlying in the whole thing, of course, I knew that she had wanted me to read it and pray about it to find that it was true, you know, but I wasn't feeling any kind of pressure to read it. I was the one that came to her and asked her for it. So I read it, and, you know, I read it a couple times during, you know, it was about a 9-month process for me. It was interesting looking back because it's kind of like the same time frame as a birthing cycle, you know. So looking back after I came out of that and became born again and just had a real relationship with Christ, you know, gave my whole life over to Christ, you know, he really was birthing something in me this whole time, you know. And so I read the Book of Mormon a couple times, you know, all the way through, and I read Moroni chapter 10, you know, 3-5, and I had this testimony. You know, I knelt by my bed and I prayed, and I really strongly like knew that I had this testimony. I really thought that I knew that, and that's the thing, is that during this whole time I was studying out the LDS Church from their perspective, and then I started getting into a few things that were, I know I was given the book called Mormonism Unmasked, and it was by Sandra Tanner is one of the co-authors of that book, and I started looking in it, and there were a few things that was saying that, you know, some serious issues with the LDS Church, and I put it away, and I didn't really want anything to do with it, you know. I felt it was just from a, you know, a really frustrated source, you know, and so I just went straight to the, you know, what they call the official materials, and so that's what I really got into, and then I started asking Mallory some questions through letters, you know, about the church that I had, and she answered them, and so pretty promptly too, you know. So that's why I figured, okay, you know, she's 15 years old, I'm 15 years old at this time, I'm asking her some serious questions about the church, and she can answer them for me. Like, this is really, you know, she knows what she's talking about, you know? And so it was months later, and, you know, the Lord, I knew that the Lord was working with me this whole time. And, you know, it was June of the next year. The whole process was about from September 2002 to June 2003. And, you know, after I had, you know, the Lord had given me a few dreams where he revealed himself to me and showed me the truth. And I battled with that afterwards, because I still had my burning in the bosom. I still had my testimony. And through those dreams, he showed me things that I hadn't known about Mormonism that I later researched, just because I had a dream about it. And I researched it. And I'm like, this is true. This is really true about what the Lord showed me in this dream about how wrong the LDS Church was. And so I started doing research, and I wasn't afraid to just look things up. And that's something that I was afraid of during that time. And that's the interesting thing, is that I wasn't LDS yet, but I had a firm testimony. Like, I knew in my heart, like, I was so strong in my faith, although I hadn't gone through the ordinance. I haven't even gone through, you know, baptism and confirmation, you know, the whole repent, you know, baptism. And so during this time, you know, it was June that I really gave my life to the Lord, and I renounced. That's the thing too, is that I first renounced everything that I had believed in during that time that wasn't true, and I gave my whole life over to the Lord. You know.
Yeah. You know, your experience with the burning in the bosom. You know, yeah. Tell more about what that was.
Yeah, I would describe it as you're reading the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon says about itself that it's an additional witness of Christ. You know, it's like, you look in the Bible, you have the stick of Judah and the stick of Joseph, and the Bible and the Book of Mormon together, you know, it's like an additional witness, you know? And so that's what I had believed about it, you know? And so the Book of Mormon read so much like the Bible that in reading the Book of Mormon, I was like, you know, this feeling that I'm getting, you know, I had this belief that it was a witness from the Holy Ghost himself that this was true, you know? And I read James 1:5 too, and that's something that really I thought had helped me in gaining this, is that if anyone asks of God, you know, for wisdom, he will give it to you. So I really felt if I followed the same path that Joseph Smith did when he supposedly prayed and to know which church was true, he claimed to have gotten that answer. And so I myself took upon myself the same footsteps to walk. And I really believed that, because that was that testimony, you know, and I could relate to Joseph Smith. You know, he was a 14-year-old boy, you know, later in 1838, he claimed that he was 14 when this happened, but I was 14 at that time too. And I was like, you know, it's possible for a young person like that to really want to know the truth. So I can really empathize with Joseph Smith at that point in his age, where I was really wanting to know that too. So, yeah. So that's the burning in the bosom for me, was just this feeling in my heart that you really know that you know. And something that I really thought strengthened it for me was that when I would pray every time, I would say, I think, like, I know that it's true. Like, I would, you know, verbally speak it out loud. I know this is true. And it, I don't want to say it helped my mind in the helping kind of sense, but it got me to recite it over and over, and it to the point where I was sure of it, but I was sure of it because I felt it. That's the biggest thing, you know. Yeah. Because I felt it.
It was an emotional, almost physiological experience.
Exactly. Yeah, uh-huh. Exactly it was.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yes. And, well, then talk about the dreams then that you had. You said you had a couple of dreams.
Okay. Yeah. So I had three dreams during that time. It was started in March of 2003. I'll go through them very briefly. But the first dream that I had was I was out in Delano, and it was kind of behind my mom's house. It was like a huge grassy woodland marsh area, and then there was you know, the North Fork of the Crow River back there. And so in my dream, everything was just bright and colorful, and in my dream I woke up out of bed and walked outside, and I was in the backyard, and I saw Joseph Smith standing there next to the end of the yard. and kind of waving this motion, hey, Adam, come follow me. You know, and it sounded really peaceful, you know, and so I started following him, and he turned his back on me and walked really fast. It was almost as if he was levitating into the woods, you know, and his coattails were, you know, kind of flowing in the wind. It was really windy. It started becoming really windy, and I followed him. I was running after him, and we finally got to a cabin in the woods, and so I went into the cabin. He invited me inside, and he said, I really want to show you how I really translated the Book of Mormon. And so I went into this cabin, and, you know, it was kind of a stereotypical cabin with a fireplace with smoke coming out of it, you know. And so I went inside, and, you know, he showed me on this table that he had with chairs all around it, you know, and we sat down, and he pulled out a hat, set it on the table, and then he pulled out a seer stone. Well, I didn't know it was a seer. I don't know what it was. It was just like a rock shaped like an egg, and it had a little hole, kind of a little hole in it. And he set it on the table, and he said, this is how I really translated the Book of Mormon, you know. And then the windows in the dream, the windows of the cabin shattered, you know, and everything kind of started turning dark, really dark and black, you know. And then I got just feeling in my dream, I was like scared. So I opened the door of the cabin and ran out, and then my dream ended. So I woke up very shocked. I was like, you know, is this something that is confirming my testimony of the burning in the bosom that I'm having, or is something really going on here, you know? So it wasn't until a couple weeks later, I had my second dream. And the second dream, it took place in Oakdale, Minnesota. And I was on my bicycle because I biked everywhere, you know, and I couldn't drive yet. And I was waiting for my license, but I was on my bicycle, and I went on my bike a couple miles north of, I grew up in Woodbury, to the town of Oakdale. And right on the corner of Hadley Avenue, I could see this bookstore just right in front of me at this intersection. And I biked up to it, and this bookstore was like right next to a gas station. And I looked in the window, but the thing was that there were bars on the windows, almost like a cell, you know, like a jail cell. There were bars in it, and then inside was like, it was this green light that was just shining out of it. And then there was a back door that had stacks of sheets of paper that were just like, you know, almost, it was probably like half the distance to the ceiling. And then it was almost as if a wind just came inside and was blowing all these papers around. And as they were blowing around, I started seeing what was written on these papers. And it was names of everyone. It was like a list of people that had been written on there by faithful members of the church, family members. It was genealogical records of who they were going to do proxy baptisms for in the temple. And it was just, everything kept flying around and flying around, and it got really windy outside. And I remember seeing the swirl in the sky. It looked like a green, like cinnamon roll, you know. It was just like it was a storm coming, you know. And then I woke up from the dream, and then I was like, you know, something's going on here, you know, the Lord's really trying to show me something. And then my third dream that I had was where I was on my bicycle again. And I went up to the same intersection, but I kept going north on the road. I kept on going that way on the road. And what had happened was I stopped, and there was an LDS temple, and it was the St. Paul, Minnesota temple. So I arrived there, and they had their stake building as well there, where they meet for church, and then the temple next to it. And in the dream right away, I walked up to the temple, and I saw this guy standing right in front of the temple door. And I introduced myself, and it was a really quick dream, but we introduced each other, and, you know, I said, what's your name? And he said, my name's Nathan. And I said, oh, my name's Adam, nice to meet you. You know, and he said, are you LDS? And I said, no, not yet. You know, and I asked if he was, and he said, yeah, I am. He said, I can't go in here yet, though, but I'm going to, and this is what I have to do, you know, to be able to do that. And I said, well, how are you saved then? How do you believe that you're saved? You know, and he said, well, I have to do this and this and this. And he listed off all of these things. And then he asked me the same question. And for some reason in my dream, I said, well, you know, it's by the grace of God that by his shed blood, he forgave us and we're forgiven, you know, if we believe in him. And immediately there was a tornado that came out of nowhere right towards the temple. And he started shaking at the doors of the temple, pounding on the doors, trying to get in, because there was a tornado and it was just really windy. And I remember the skies were still green. I don't, you know, it was just interesting. The skies were still green And we were both trying to get into the tent, you know, and he was LDS, he said, and he couldn't even get in. And I'm like, why can't you, you're LDS, why can't you? And he said, but I haven't done what I need to do. I'm not worthy enough. You know, I'm not worthy enough to get in. And it was just amazing that that had happened, you know, and then the dream ended. So it was each one of them, it finished right as something was about to happen. But what was interesting was the following year in the summer of, the fall of 2004, when I was in my 11th grade year of high school, I had a group of friends, and there was a guy that kind of came into our group of friends, and he was like, hey, my name is Nate. And I was like, oh, my name's Adam, nice to meet you. And, you know, I didn't really know him well at first, but one of my friends was, we were talking about church for some reason. He said, yeah, Nate's LD, you know, Nate's a Mormon. You know, I was like, really? You know, so I came to him and started talking to him, and, you know, and I had no idea he was a Mormon because he smoked a lot. You know, after school, he would go out and smoke and things like that. And he was like, well, you know, I'm a Jack Mormon. You know, so he said I wasn't born in the covenant. You know, my parents were converts, and, you know, they never went to the temple, and they never held a temple recommend, you know. And so he said, you know, I believe in some of it, but there's some of it that's just, you know, there's a lot of rules, and it's a real burden, you know. And he got into a lot of smoking and drinking in high school, you know, because you could just see on him he was really struggling with it. And he actually tried giving me a copy of the Book of Mormon, which was interesting because he wasn't so sure about it himself, you know. So
now, all the dreams that you had, did they reveal information that you hadn't learned previously, like the reading in the hat, and was that new to you? I mean, was it like a revelation from the dream, or was it just a replay of something that you had heard?
It was complete revelation to me. Like, I hadn't heard of the stone in the hat or anything. I had heard of LDS temples because I had seen the Salt Lake one, right. But the location, I had no clue that there was a Mormon bookstore there or a temple. And I actually went on my bike not long after that and found it. And so it was just interesting. So it just blew my mind, and I was like, okay, that's when I realized this is real. But where is it coming from? And so I started researching, and I really started looking at, you know, just Googling. And some people kind of think that, you know, they like to say, well, you know, looking something up or just Googling it, you know, it's not a source. So you know, for me to answer that, I would say, you know what, it's not a source. It's a search engine. So it's a means to try and find information, you know. And so I just started looking things up for myself and found actual testimonies of the people that were around Joseph Smith to say that, hey, you know, the golden plates weren't even involved. You know, they weren't even involved like they portray it. You know, he had a stone that he had found previously on a money digging trip when he had found it in a well, I believe, you know, and it was a speck. I think it was like a lighter colored, and it was speckled, and, you know, he had found it, and he would put it in a hat, you know. And I learned that when he would put the seer stone in a hat, he would put the hat up to his face so that all light could not shine in there. And then there was something spiritual that would happen where light would shine out of that stone, and characters would appear, and they would give the English, it would say what it was in English, you know, underneath that. And then he would then give it to his scribe, and then that character would not go away until he had, you know, until he had written it down, and then the next one would appear, you know. And, you know, I feel like for him, since he did that, it worked up until certain points, you know, and then he would just use the King James Bible to copy down chapter after chapter, you know, of the book of Isaiah, another chapter, you know, like Matthew 5-7 is just copied almost word for word in 3rd Nephi, you know, the Sermon on the Mount becomes the Sermon on the Temple, you know, here in the Americas. So it's like there's things where Joseph Smith he was very smart the way that he organized everything. He knew what he was doing. But when it came time for the seer stone, you know, it would work and then it wouldn't work, you know, he would have to interject with these other things, you know, and have fill in chapters where he would put the Bible in. So that to me was very crushing. But the thing was, is that something in me was still just like, you know, but I have a testament, but I know that this is true. And for me, I was like, you know, the seer stone, that must have been something that God had given him to use to translate it, you know. But then why would have the Nephi prophets gone through all of that trouble in writing that record on the golden plates and burying it? You know, Moroni, he had left the battle and he had went and buried the plates for 1400 years only to be dug up and hid from people. You know, Joseph Smith claimed to have ran a few miles, you know, carrying these, you know, close to 200 pound plates with him to protect them, only for them to not have been used in the translation. And then the angel Moroni conveniently, you know, takes them back, takes the record back up. And so to me, that was a huge, huge pin that was taken out of the testimony being held together, really. It was because, you know, previous LDS prophets have said, you know, the testimony of Joseph Smith and the Book of Mormon, like our religion, you know, Gordon B. Hinckley even said, it depends on it. It was either, and same with the First Vision account, if it stands, then this is the most amazing work that we have ever seen on this planet. And if it doesn't, it's a fraud, and we are involved in a fraud. And it's something that serious, because that's the foundation of it. Because recently, there's so many things that, you know, the LDS Church really wants to portray itself as a Christian organization, and there's so many things that they're, you know, they've got great family values. Like, I highly respect a lot of things that they do, but you have to look at, you know, what we're seeing right now, it's a lot of branches from the tree, and you can see really, you can see with your natural eyes good, you know, what appears as good things coming from it. But what you have to do is really look at the foundation, because what you have to do with something that has a foundation that is not good at its core, you can't just remodel the house. You can't just remodel it. You need to go down underneath the foundation and you need to chisel away at the cement, and you need to completely take out the foundation and replace it with Christ, really. So when I realized that this was going on, and the church wasn't even telling its members at the time, it wasn't fully out with this information, I had realized, you know, this is very serious. They're covering up their foundation. And you have to go back to 1820, 1827, 1830, and really look at what was going on during that foundational time. What was the base of Mormonism? Because sometimes, yeah, it's great that they're going through a lot of things right now to try and, change things, but you still, their foundation is still based on that work, the work of Joseph Smith. And that's something that for me, I realized you got to get at the foundation of this, you know.
How long did this process take from when you were starting to uncover the problems? Take me through that process of how the evidence won, I guess, you know.
Sure, yeah. So I started having, you know, my testimony of the LDS Church that was true. September 2002, and then when that testimony, and when I realized the truth, when the Lord revealed to me the truth, you know, was June 2003, really. But it started really rupturing during March 2003, so it was about 6 months that I was fully, fully into it. And then the rest of that time, the dream, you know, the dreams occurred, but I was still believing in it. I was finding a way to rationalize it away, because the testimony was ultimately, you know, and the promise of having my family sealed to me eventually, that was a huge thing that I sought to have done, you know. And losing that, to me, was something eternal, losing something eternal. And that's how deep I was in that, you know, my LDS testimony, is that I wanted to become LDS so badly. When I became LDS and was baptized, I was planning to go to BYU. I wanted to move out to Utah. You know, I wanted to get married, have like 5 or 6 kids, you know, and I wanted to climb my way up into the church. You know, that's what I really wanted to do, get as high as I could get, because there's just that progression mindset there that I really wanted to work my way up. You know, I didn't want to have a job and something else. I wanted to work for the church, and only for the church. Working in the church office building and work my way up, or try to. I wanted to just try to do that. And so it really started coming out when I had these dreams, the Lord started speaking to me. But then one day in May of 2003, it was when I had all my books. I had my Book of Mormon, my binder that I had written everything in and printed all these pages off from their websites. You know, I had a journal saying how I was so excited for this journey and I just wish that everyone could understand, you know. And I remember that day in May, that weekend when my mom was about to drive us back to my dad's house, and I was out working on a fort with my brother outside, and my mom came outside holding all of my stuff, and my parents, like, I kept this from my whole family the whole time, and so she came out with all of the stuff that I had and just whipped it in front of me and threw it in front of me at my feet and just said, and really started letting me have it, you know, and said, if this is, you know, you're going to hell, you know, this is a cult, you know, you cannot join this. Like, I didn't raise you this way. This isn't what you're supposed to be getting into. You know, if you decide to do this, I want no part of it. You know, this is serious, you know. And I was so in shock that I stood there, you know, and she walked off, went back inside, you know, and I stood there and looked down at everything, and it was still precious to me, you know. And that reaction, that deep of a reaction to me, I started getting this persecution, like they say, the persecution complex inside of me that said, well, because this is the true church, of course people are going to be reacting to me like this, you know. And so I took everything up, wiped the gravel off of my Book of Mormon, you know, and I've kept on believing it, you know. And it made me want to join the LDS Church even more. So that's something that I would say too. I do not, in a way, like, I don't look back at that though and say, why in the world did she do that? Because part of that was coming from the fact that she had a heart as a mother and a responsibility to know what I was getting into. That's the important thing that I want to say, because I can't fault her for that. You know, she genuinely wants me to know the truth. But sometimes in an approach like that, you really have to watch it with what exactly you say. And sometimes things really take time. And I think it was because that reaction came because they had no idea, absolutely no idea. As a matter of fact, I had been lying to them about that, because I was still attending my Lutheran youth group and I would still, you know, worship there and everything. And I had told one of my youth pastors there that I was actually trying to help this girl, Mallory, to come to church, when really I was with her and wanting to become LDS. So that's what I had told my mom during the time, you know, that I was really trying to reach out to her, you know, but really behind the scenes, I was believing it, you know. So that kind of came crashing. And finally, I went on a youth trip down to Cincinnati with my Lutheran, you know, youth group. And we went out there, and I you know, we had some classes in the Cincinnati Convention Center. We just attended, and we would sit in, you know, round tables and everything, just a bunch of 15, 16-year-olds. And we had a huge youth group, and we sat there talking about the Bible. And me, I was still thinking, you know, I'm, you know, maybe I can talk to some of these, you know, out, you know, after the meeting, start telling everything about, you know, the restored gospel, and, you know, how Jesus is my older brother as well, and, you know, how amazing it is that we sided valiantly in the pre-existence with Jesus. We were, and just things like, you know, things like this, I really wanted them to know. And so what had happened was, during that time in meeting with these youth, I had realized that, hey, they're not LDS, but look at the joy that they have. Look at how they're talking about Jesus. That's not how I learned about Jesus in the manuals that I was reading. And granted, by this time, I hadn't even gone to an LDS sacrament meeting. I hadn't even attended a ward meeting at all, you know, because I didn't want my parents to suspect anything. You know, I wanted to still attend church where they were, but deep down, like, I knew that it was true. I thought I knew it was true. And what happened after being with these other youth in my youth group is that we went to they had a few Christian concerts. You know, they had Toby Mac and Reliant K and Cutlass and Rebecca St. James. And I remember hearing them, you know, in some of the worship music that they were playing. And I was like, wow, they're just, you know, just really sold out to the Lord. And I said, how can they have this when there's no, you know, in LDS services, there's, you know, it's very quiet. And I'm all about hymns. You know, hymns are amazing, you know, and there's some great, great hymns out there. But it was just a different paradigm shift to me. I was like, wow, there's people that are playing guitars and they're just lifting their hands. And there was, so there were thousands of people that filled that convention, you know, Christian youth that filled this place. And I was like, this is amazing. Like, I want this, you know? And that's when that really started shifting in me, is on the bus ride back. We stopped at Indiana Dunes State Park, right on Lake Michigan there. And we were at a campfire in the woods, you know, and it was a testimony night, was the last night. And all the youth got up there and they handed them a microphone, anyone that wanted to talk. And there were like 120 of us, you know, in a circle. And saying their testimony, and they were like, you know, this is such a great trip. I had so much fun on the bus ride and listening to cool music. And, you know, I just love this youth group. And then the next person would get up and kind of say similar things. And, you know, and I had something inside of me felt like I needed to go to the youth leader, tap on her shoulder and say, I have something to say. I really need to say something. And so I did that, and she was about to wrap it up and say, is there anyone else? And I was the last person, and I finally tapped on her shoulder and I said, I really need to say something. So she handed me the microphone and I stood up on the picnic table, just on the top of the picnic table in front of everyone. And I just cried out to God and I said, I just wanted to let you all know that I have been completely deceived, and behind your backs, I've been believing this. And I have been, and it wasn't necessarily behind your backs, but I was saying this in the presence of the Lord, that I haven't been truthful about what I believed. You know, even you look at the, you know, one of the last articles of faith, you know, we believe in following everything that's virtuous and with a good report and, you know, having these things. But me, as almost becoming LDS, I wasn't fulfilling one of those articles of faith because I was hiding this. It was a secret. You know, I wasn't being honest, you know. And so I, in front of the youth group, I just renounced everything to do with the LDS church and my false teachings, and I gave my life to Christ right there in front of everyone. And no one expected it either. They didn't really know what to, they were just so happy. They started clapping and gave me hugs and, you know, and everything like that. But it just changed my life right in that instant. And the thing was that something I'd really like to say is that I never let go of Jesus during the whole time. I just let go of misconceptions about Jesus. And that's the important thing, is that in the LDS church, Jesus and the church, they really tend to see them as they go together hand in hand. But something that when you find out that the LDS church isn't true, are you still going to stay with Jesus? And that is the big thing. That's the big thing that came for me, because it's like I wasn't technically LDS, but in my heart, I was very much LDS. And to the degree that I believed in it, you know, I believed what the modern day prophets have spoken. You know, I listened to, you know, I read their general conference notes and things like that, you know, Ensign articles online, you know, and I just realized, hey, you know, I'm letting all of this go because the gospel is this simple, that I just need to follow Christ. And the whole time I had believed in Jesus. And it's interesting because the whole time I believed in Jesus, and I knew that he was near me. But I knew that he was bringing me through this to a new birth. So I don't look back and say, why in the world did I go through this and believe all of this? It was, at first I thought it was a temptation. One of my pastors once said, there's a difference between a trial and a temptation. A trial is something that God brings you through. And a temptation is something that the devil wants you to fall through. So I realized years later that this was just it wasn't a temptation for me, it was a trial, because I needed to go through this, you know, and that's part of my walk with the Lord, is my experience with this, you know. And so I think there's can be a lot of shame sometimes and guilt for feeling so, you know, LDS, feel the ones that are feeling so burdened with the work and for being worthy enough, it's that by whose standards are you worthy enough? Realizing that our good works are just a byproduct of our faith, but they're not so that we can be worthy. And it's not a precursor to grace, because there's nothing we can do to attain that grace. You know, we can't make it 50% of the way, 75% of the way, until we're just worn out and then have nothing left, and then grace applies. You know, it doesn't work that way, you know.
How do you think that experience in Mormonism has benefited your walk with Christ today? And what practical ways do you see that happening?
Yeah, I see that just the Lord just working with people that you might not think he can work with. And that's amazing, because sometimes you can see the outward appearances of someone and think and see, wow, they look really well put together. They're whitewashed tombs, but inside they're full of dead man's bones, you know? And for me, it's encouraging to know that God can use someone that might look great, you know, really great. They, you know, and he can use a Catholic, he can use a Baptist, he can use someone that is just really involved in drugs or any kind of lifestyle to bring him out. Like in 1 Corinthians, I think 6, I believe, it's, you know, some of you were in this, but now you're set free. You know, it's like listing all of these different things that people were strongholds in their lives. They had walls built up because of it, but now look where they are. God used them, you know? And to just think that God can use LDS people, God uses Latter-day Saints. And some of them, they're in the process, you know, he's working with them, and it's a process, you know? You know, and for me, salvation was instantaneous, but then it was, you know, afterwards, it was a process to, you know, God kept on working with me. And that's the thing, is that, you know, the Lord, just knowing that regardless of what church you're in, even if it's the LDS church, God can still use you because he's leading you to something. And that's really, really important to realize. And so he was really good, because even before, you know, Moses and the people came out of the Exodus and everything, it's like, when Joshua and Caleb went into the promised land, you know, they had seen what had happened before, but the only reason why they were the ones Joshua was allowed to lead the people afterwards is because he came back with a good report. And I feel like he saw so much of what Moses had gone through with the people and how the people were rising up, but that Joshua didn't take the chance to overthrow Moses, is that he stood by him during the time when Moses led them out and was able to be the one that led them into the promised land. So it's like a lot of times, like LDS people, and I don't have the experience of being LDS in the culture, you know, and going to sacrament meeting and anything like that. So I can't speak to that experience, but as far as being in my heart, I was LDS, but that's how I viewed it. Even though I know that God didn't see me that way, he saw me, he was working with me. But I knew that during the time I was getting involved in this, Jesus was still there with me. He was still there with me, and he was holding my hand in that. So he was leading. It was my exodus out of it, if you will, before I even entered it. And that's the thing, is that I really believe that the timing of it, God saved me from it so that I wouldn't have to go, you know, go into it. And, you know, just like I've heard, you know, some stories of some LDS, you know, leaving the church before they, you know, they didn't get a chance to go to the temple, you know. And I think that, well, that's so amazing. It doesn't make your testimony any less important, because God saved you from something, you know. And so it was just, you know, God can really, he works, he meets you where you are, and he works with you through it.
Do you see the contrast more sharply now between what Mormonism teaches and biblical faith?
Yes, absolutely. There's a sharp contrast. There is. And the thing, though, that right after that, after I had found the Lord and renounced everything, I was actually bitter for a while. I was very bitter, especially learning what I did about Joseph Smith and his character throughout his life. I became very bitter about it, you know, and inside I felt like I was an anti, you know, I didn't consider myself an anti-Mormon, but I was very bitter with Mormonism, for sure, you know, and I hadn't talked to many Mormons really that long after that, but inside I was so bitter because I had been deceived, and I was embarrassed, part of me was so embarrassed. I mean, that's not something that you want to bring up to someone and tell them that you were just that deceived, but you know, who hasn't been deceived by something? You know, who hasn't done something? And it's like, it just realized, you know, I just realized that it was just amazing coming out of that and having life, having this unspeakable joy, you know, that just came with my relationship with Christ after that and leading up to it. So I see that, yeah, there's definitely a sharp contrast, you know, after I had learned all of this, but my approach with it was definitely not right. And I had learned that, hey, like, the Mormon people need to be loved. Walter Martin, a while ago once said, it was really neat. He said, you know, we need to see Mormons as, you know, even though they're not our brothers in Christ, they're our brothers in Adam. And it was so powerful for me because I started realizing that they are creations of God just like we are. They're a person. Like, they have a life. Like, outwardly, you might see, oh, well, you know, they go to the temple and who knows what they do. And, you know, you can start to have these thoughts. But then when you realize that they are just precious people, which they are, and you have that love for them that Christ did, that really changed my life in a whole new way, you know. And this was back in 2008, 2009, you know, when I had a Mormon friend at my college who I talked to for a while, and he was so broken, you know, and his parents had died. He had no brothers and sisters, and he just had his grandmother living. And she was a Pentecostal woman. She grew up in the Church of God down in Cleveland, Tennessee. And, you know, he became a Mormon when he was about 15 years old. And I knew him when I was 19, and he had gone on a 2-year mission with the church to Chicago. And he was in our band, and in our symphonic band, he played the clarinet. And something that was really interesting was that he had this condition where he was allergic to almost every food. He could only eat a certain type of bread and water for his diet and certain vitamins, and that's it. And so he was very, very, he was very skinny, and he had a lot of health issues. And I started talking to him a little bit, and I said, you know, when did you always have this? When did it start? And he said, well, I was around 16 when all these issues started happening. And I said, okay. So I listened to him, because the thing that we need to realize as Christians is that we need to value LDS people and their views. We need to take the time to sit there and listen to them and just say, you're one of God's creations. Like, I value you. Like, they need to feel valued, you know? So I sat there and just listened to him, and I just said, when did you become LDS? He said, well, around 15. So it's just interesting to me that this condition, you know, had followed that, you know? And he shared with me a lot of his mission pictures and said that he had a, you know, a really fun time and everything. And, you know, and we shared a lot of jokes and everything. And then it came one time on a symphonic band tour that we were sitting down at a table and in a cafeteria at a church. And a bunch of other guys came to sit by us, you know, and Christian guys, you know, and they started making some jokes with him about polygamy. And started saying, so how many, when you graduate, how many wives are you going to have? You know, and I was sitting there and it really got to me, because I was thinking, you can't do this. And, you know, my Mormon friend got up and moved to the other end of the table. So I got up and I moved with him. you know, and I was talking to him a little bit more, and I just said, I'm so sorry, you know, I'm really sorry that that happened, and, you know, I want to get to know you more and everything, and I said, you know, they shouldn't have acted like, you know, they shouldn't have responded like that, but they were just speaking out of ignorance, you know, and something that I ended up doing, we ended up, you know, we were roommates, not roommates in a dorm, but while we traveled with symphonic band. And he started sharing, he would pull out his triple combination at night, and he would have his, you know, readings in the Book of Mormon before bed and everything. And, you know, I didn't, you know, didn't get offended at that. And I said, no, I'm not going to sleep in the same room if you're going to, you know, have a Book of Mormon in here and everything. And, you know, I let him do that. And I, you know, and I'd pray for him, but, you know, by myself, I'd, you know, before bed, I would be praying for him, you know. And one night we were just talking about family and everything, and he said, you know, there's something about Joseph Smith that I'm really having some questions about, and I'm really struggling with. And I just said to him, has there ever been anything at all that you've questioned, that you've, you know, have a doubt about, and you know, within the LDS Church? And he said, you know, there's some really tough things that I'm really that I've been finding out, that I've really having a problem with.
Now, did he know about your Mormon background or your?
At this point, he didn't. No, I eventually shared that with him. And then when I left college, he went his own way. He actually married a Baptist girl, didn't get married in the temple. I eventually shared that with him before we, you know, kind of parted ways there at school. But we got to go through a little bit. I had, you know, we looked at the Doctrine and Covenants together, and he kind of shared what some issues he had, mostly between the 1833 Book of Commandments and then the 1835 Doctrine and Covenants, how there were so many changes and things deleted and added in, and, you know, changes from it, and the amount of word changes in Doctrine and Covenants. There's actually more changes in that book than there are in the Book of Mormon. You know, I know Sandra Tanner's book, you know, 3,913 changes in the Book of Mormon. I mean, that's amazing, and, you know, there's so many more word changes in the Doctrine and Covenants, of how many changes there have been, you know, the priesthood being added in later on, you know, when no one had even heard of the priesthood when it was claimed to have been restored. You know, it wasn't until the early 1830s, you know, and so there were these are foundational things that he had a lot of questions about. So, but the thing was, is that I always pointed him to LDS sources for these things, you know, is that there are really good books out there, and you can use a lot of really good books to talk about these things, but to an LDS person who's really has some questions, you know, by just using their books and their materials, you can show, because that's a tool in their tool belt that you can use, you know, and we have to have the right tools in our tool belt to use, you know. A lot of times that, you know, I love different versions of the Bible, you know, and I have my favorites, the New American Standard Bible and everything, you know, but you know, you try talking to a Mormon, you know, with your NIV and pull it out and start reading it to them, it's kind of a different story, you know. You just kind of have to know, you know. So I don't have a problem using the King James, and, you know, and just say, because they can relate to it. It's something that they've respected and that they can, you know, relate to. So that made it just really easy to talk to him during that time, really relate to him. So
that's a good word.
Yeah,
that's a good word.
So,
is there anything else that's on your heart to talk about? Anything other what you shared so far?
Yeah, I would just say that, you know, to any LDS searching for the truth, I would just say that you know, continually read the Bible. I mean, especially the New Testament, read it as a child, you know, like read through the Gospels, and don't be afraid to search things out, you know, because we all have questions. We all have questions, you know. And, you know, look how many times God asked questions to Job over and over. And it's not because he didn't know the answer, but he just wanted Job's interaction, you know? And because God is that great, you know, that we all go through periods of time where we have questions about things, but not to be afraid, because I know it was President Uchtdorf, I believe, that said in a recent general conference message, doubt your doubts. You know, it was really trying to counsel the LDS people to doubt your doubts. And for me, that's something where I listened to that and I said, well, you can doubt your doubts, but you can't doubt your faith. You can doubt your doubts, but you can't doubt the Book of Mormon, you know? And so if you're doubting something, that's okay, you know? It's okay to have questions, but knowing in the process that, you know, you can find the truth, that it's not based off of feelings. Like the burning in the bosom for me, I really felt that that was true. You know, it was based on what I felt. And having the truth, like the Word of God, brings life. So for me, it's like living the LDS life, I wouldn't have been able to fully live and just from the inside out be renewed, like day by day, just renewed with that joy. And that's something that I believe that the Lord really, you know, worked with me so that I came out of it before I got into it, you know. And I've had so many struggles since I've been saved. Like life hasn't been easy, but the thing is that the Lord has had a hand in my life. And that is the amazing thing about grace. You know, in the LDS Bible dictionary, you know, at the end of their Bible, they have that Bible dictionary, and you look up the word grace, the definition of grace to them, you know, and it, I'm just paraphrasing, but it's, you know, something about, you know, grace is applied after we have extended our own efforts. And it's like, you know, the only saving work is His work, not ours. There is nothing, no effort I can put forth to do, you know, to attain salvation. It was because of His work on the cross, you know, because if I were to pay my tithe and to follow all of the commandments would be impossible, you know? And that's something that only Christ could do. I can't add anything to the cross. You know, I can't stand before the cross and add anything. I can't chisel anything into the cross that I could do. Like, it was all done. So I would just have to say that, you know, go forward in grace, you know, because I love the LDS people, you know, and there is hope and joy in just knowing the true Jesus Christ. There's a lot of misconceptions that the LDS church teaches about Jesus. So it's you know, there's some that don't know Jesus, but there's some that they might have a lot of doctrines wrong in their head, but it's a mystery. You know, I do believe that some of them, you know, they have Jesus there, and they're really seeking the truth, you know, and just the promise to tell them that, hey, you found Him, you know, you've found Him now, and you're out, but now, you know, just receive, you know, what the Bible has to say about Jesus. It's amazing. Yeah. It's just amazing.
And so how would you answer the challenge? Like, well, you know, you just believe and pray your little prayer, and then you can go live like the devil if you want because you're saved.
Yeah. That's a really good question, actually. I met with last summer when I was here in Utah. I actually drove down to BYU and I met with Dr. Robert Millett. Actually, he took my wife and I out for lunch, and I just wanted to have a conversation with him and just get to know him and everything. And something that he said that was really interesting was that, you know, sometimes a lot of LDS think about Christians that, well, they're saved by grace and then they can just do whatever they want to do after that, you know. And something that I found that it's that, you know, we're saved by grace. But then the interesting thing is that that doesn't mean that that grace is a license to continue on in that lifestyle that we had before. You know, I know it mentions in Jude, I don't remember what verse, but it talks about just, you know, don't turn the grace that you've been given, you know, into that. And so it's just that grace is the enabling. It's the enabling power of the Lord in that covenant relationship to Him, with Him. That our good works are just showing Him, our love for Him. So I would just say that faith is very important. Yeah, good works, they're also very important. But faith is the only way that we can be saved, because it's by His doing that we're saved. But we endure, we're running this race of life, and we endure to the end, So we have that faith every day, and we live out our good works because of what He did, because we love Him, not as a precursor to become worthy, and that's the thing, is that He is the one that's worthy. And that turned my life around. A lot of times, I've heard so many testimonies from LDS who have left the church, and then they'll get, either scolded or talked to by active members saying, well, they didn't really have a testimony. They really weren't in it fully in the beginning when they're being led captive by the devil and things like that. But really, a lot of these people, they had solid testimonies. They had testimonies. So it wasn't that they couldn't live it. It's just that they found Christ, and that set them free.
What do you think was the source of your testimony in reality?
In reality? I mean, the source of it, I mean, obviously, the devil is the accuser of the brethren, and he seeks to kill and destroy. And ultimately, he's the source of deception. And I just felt that, in my flesh, I felt that it was right. In my own mind, I had Jesus in my heart, but in my mind, I was just like, how can I, I feel like this is true. I really feel like this is true. So I feel like it was really a natural emotion that, really deceived me. Can I mention something about my book that I'm...
Sure.
That
yeah.
Is that okay? Okay. Yeah, no, I'm actually almost finished with a book that I'm writing now called Almost a Mormon, and the subtitle is Why I Almost Joined the Mormon Church But Didn't. And it's just my story about everything, and about a year ago I started an outreach called Latter-day Saints Ministries, and it's something that I've been just writing articles on Mormonism to be able to help people that are really, really searching, to network with other Christian ministries with, And so it's something where the mission is just really to reach Mormons with biblical Latter-day common sense, to realize that the name of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, that's a name that the LDS Church uses. But what's really interesting is that the true Church of God, the body of believers, we are the Church of Jesus Christ, and we are in the latter days. So we are, us as believers, we are saints, and we're in the latter days. So it's like, it's kind of an irony there, But it's like, I named it that just because it's like, I want to be able to, I just have such a heart for the LDS people, And it's like, I'm not anti-Mormon, it's just anti-Mormonism, And so it's just showing the love of God through the Bible, showing what Jesus Christ did. And that's what that's just what my hope and prayer to convey to the LDS people is that it's okay to search the Bible and search out Joseph Smith, the life of Joseph Smith, and just rely solely on God. So that's... just so that the church as a whole, that we have that Latter-day sense. We have that sense to be able to know that that we trust and hope in God, because He's the only thing that can bring life and abundant life. So that's just my hope and prayer to the LDS people. So.
Excellent. Great word.
And that's it.
That's it. All right.
That's my testimony.
All right. Well, thanks again for sharing with us. That was really great.